Welcome back to another episode of Let's Look At It Again, and this is part two. We have our special guest, Elder Darryl Waistline Mitchell. We're going to continue our talk on the Black Underclass in America.
I was actually a founding member of the Communist Labor Party. And that's Communist Labor Party, United States of North America, because it represents a distinct history and a distinct continuity that is three generations of Black Marxists, right, who have roots in the old Communist International, the Comintern, which is the international organization that was actually set up by Lenin and Stalin. And by that, I mean to say that we carried water, if you will, for the people who carried water from the comrades that was like in the Comintern. For instance, you had Admiral Kilpatrick, right, who was a political commissar in the Comintern. In fact, Admiral was sent to like Spain, I think in 37, 38, to clean up some of the Trotskyites and things like that. So when we talk about the Communist Labor Party, we're talking about a continuity in the communist and Marxist movement in our country. And in this, it's in some of that history that tells the story of why I was able to get with some more of the comrades and produce what is, I think, the first Marxist glossary by an American communist, right, who had ties to organizations. Our glossary is the first one. And what's different about it is that it's the only glossary ever been produced. And the first word it looks up is abolition and abolitionism under A. Abolitionism because we're abolitionists on the side of the proletariat. That's the American story of communism. Now, Marxist Glossary Facebook, for the listeners, it's a Facebook page, man, that you just got to look up, sign up for, and try and learn something. Then we have this part of this history, the old League of Revolutionary Black Workers. The League of Revolutionary Black Workers was founded in January, right, 1969, but it grew out of another series of events that was just absolutely fascinating, fun, and on the sharp edge of the social movement in the 60s, Detroit and stuff like that. The League of Revolutionary Black Workers started off with a UAW caucus by Black young revolutionaries and stuff, man, who was working in the Chrysler system and faced these barriers of segregation and stuff, you know. So the brothers come out fighting and swinging. You got notables like General Gordon Baker, Mike Hamlin, Kenneth Cockrell, John Watson, John Williams, you know. These are like heavyweights and giants in our history. And some of this is talked about in the book, Detroit, I Do Mine Dying, by Martin Serkin and Dan Georgiakis. Yeah, Detroit, I Do Mine Dying. You can find it. Google it. You can find it. But the League of Revolutionary Black Workers, its importance in history is that it's literally the last industrial formal organization to engage the enemy, man, on the basis of the factory system. And we had the soundtrack for it, man, coming out of Motown. Shit. We had a ball. And I guess that's why when we talk about the theme of the underclass, and we talk about Black people, underclass, Black workers, the Midwest of the country, right? Detroit, like, and that lens would be a good way to see this new thing that took place. The auto industry, right? They were going through technological innovation first, man, and it was throwing hundreds of thousands of people out of the proletariat, right, out of the working class with a high wage into the destitute. Before, when we talked about this word lumping proletariat, we talked about how this group, right, came about as the result of the breakdown of the feudal system. The decomposition of the feudal system created a lumping proletariat. The decomposition of the old capitalist system that rested upon industrial technology is burning high-paid workers and throwing them into the destitute. Before, if you were destitute under feudalism, you became more destitute because there was no place for you to fit in. Well, It's a tiny similarity between them, but we're talking about the breakdown of what was a prosperous working class whose connection to industry was that it worked. We're talking about a working class now that might not never work. And we call them and identify them a working class because they came out of the working class. They didn't come out of the surplus population and unemployed that was already there. So that's how we use words in a way where what we have to is trying to describe the situation that unfolded in front of us. But as we lived it in Detroit, man, oh baby, we went from rags to riches every 36 months, right? Because that was the cycle of buying and selling in the 60s and 70s and stuff like that. You know, today the cycles have become more extended and more permanent, right? You know, I mean, technology, man, and see, they call it labor saving, but that's not accurate. It destroys human labor and production, right? And it creates a society where you only can get work servicing people. Now, the problem with that is that in the old capitalism, they needed workers who service people because these was people who worked and couldn't do the things that you get paid to do. What I'm saying is we used to have a situation where people would service the workers who service industry. But since you're destroying industry and you just got people servicing other people, that market is going to be narrow and it's only going to consist of people who get paid enough to be serviced. It's very complicated what we're going through, but we're literally going through the destruction of society, all forms of society that grew up on the basis of needing human labor as the determinant of what you would do in life, that you were born into a social division of labor, that's being destroyed. This is a revolution bigger than anything we've faced since the discovery of fire, man. This one off the scales, it's off the charts. So yes, I understand why folks would try to describe something that seemed to be under and beneath. But see, you had some guy who did a book, a little pamphlet called Beneath the Underclass. And you can Google that, right? See, I forget who that was because I didn't got old. But yeah, the name of his little thing was Beneath the Underclass. What's being described is the destruction of the whole society. And it's reasons why that come about. And that's where Marxism, the science of society, comes in. It tells you why it's happening, you know? But yeah, I think I can open right there.
Yeah, so I wanted to dig a little bit into how you were introduced into Marxist thought and why you feel it's relevant for Black people in America. And this is important because, you know, this show is centered around the Black African experience in America and the world. And one thing I want to do as I'm learning and as I'm, you know, developing in my studies and my understanding is I want to get a greater view of what we got wrong in history as far as Black social movements. What did we get wrong in history? What pieces do we need to leave behind and what things should we have picked up?
That's a lot. Let's see if we can cover some of it. The reason why Marxism, the science of society, is important to Black people is the same reason it's important for everything, for world culture, literature, for the existence of humanity. But it's not like this is something exclusive for Black people or nothing like that. Science is like math, 2 + 2 = 4. Marxism, the science of society, it creates a language for you to discuss and understand the different parts of the society. For instance, some of the language is class, superstructure, economy. What is economy? Production and distribution of what's produced. Money, what is money? A medium of exchange. Marxism is a science of society. Its importance is that if you want to know, not just for Black people, if you live on the planet Earth and you want to know about society, the only modern literature you're going to read describing it in real terms is Marxist literature and Marxist foundational concepts. there exists no other literature on earth that does that. And I'm saying it like that because this science we call Marxism has a history, and most certainly its history go all the way back in front of antiquity, you know, all the way back into Mother Africa itself and the early formation of concepts of what we would call philosophy. So Marxism is important in real time because it tells us why and how qualitative change in the means of production, robots, computers. I remember when they first showed up in Kant, right? It tells you why qualitative changes in the means of production tear society out of its foundation and all social order as it demands people reorganize around the new means of production. So all of your older relations, right? They're torn asunder. The Marxists be saying stuff like, all that is solid melts. And I was like, damn, baby, I love that. But Marxism gives you a way to understand society. I was fortunate enough to run into it when I was like 16. And that was from being in Detroit at the right time. Sometimes you just be in the right place in the right time, you know, and that was Detroit.
So you were 16. What about what year was this?
1968.
So you're talking about at the height of the civil rights movement.
Well, you know, yes, and see, okay, in 67 was the Great Rebellion in Detroit, which was the most significant uprising against the state since the Civil War. Now, you had 1965 Watts, and Watts served this function in history as completing the encirclement of U.S. imperialism by the fighting colonial masses, us, in Heartland. Saying, okay, the king's paradise, you still have to pay with your life. We don't like it. We reject the nonviolence as a strategy. Watts represented that in August 1965. 2 years later, July 23rd, 1967, that red hot night, man, that summer, rebellion. Now, the rebellion came about as the result of a blind pig right after our joint being raided by the police. When people hear the story, they get the wrong idea because they conjure a picture, an image of an underclass, poor people, the destitute in rebellion. But what actually happened was the police raided after our joint. Now, after our joint stayed open after 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning, and they sold illegal liquor and whiskey. And if you wanted to get something to eat and they got the music playing, that meant you had to have money. See, and you were like an auto worker or working in related industries, and you had a lion in your pocket every Friday, man. You had that money, that paper. So you get off of work, you hit the shower, and you hit the after-hour joint. Well, the police decided to raid it. But in after-hour joints are these workers who gained a sense of collectivity in the factory, and half of them was soldiers. So they fought, man. That's what inaugurated the 1967 rebellion. The police attempted to raid an area, a place, an establishment of the higher paid workers who were trying to fight and kill. So it was on.
Let me ask you really quick. I'm sorry to interrupt you. Yeah. These after hour joints, these social spots, were mm-hmm. these integrated establishments or were these pretty much like black owned and black populated spots? They were
black, absolutely black. They were black. They wasn't segregated in the sense that white people or anybody else was prevented from coming in. It's just that when you're in a black neighborhood like Detroit, I mean, Detroit was real black now. I don't know if you ain't never been in a really, truly black city, it might be hard to see and understand this. But Detroit was black, man.
At that time, Detroit was like the black Mecca, like they call Atlanta, Georgia today.
Yeah. Yeah, it was like that. It wasn't on the scale of Atlanta, because Atlanta is magnificent within itself, you know. So you had the police raid, man, of a spot, man, frequented by the higher paid workers who had a sense of organization and collectivity. So a year later, in 1968, man, rebellion broke out in the Chrysler system. The formation of a group that would call itself DRUM, Dodge Revolutionary Union Movement. The reason it called itself drum, because we've been hearing drum beats, man, ever since they beat us down and brought us to the New World and shit. We've been hearing that sound, man, of freedom, man, for like, well, 600 years in this, you know, recent time frame. But even before then, man, when we was fighting, man, throughout the Middle East and shit, man, against Arab, well, when you use the word Arab, people conjure the wrong thing. But see, we was fighting invaders before the white people. But we heard drum beats, man, and the organization called itself Drum. And it was an organization whose job, whose task was to tear down the last walls of segregation in the auto industry and in the UAW. We were not ass kissers, man. We didn't go along with Walter Reuther. Our slogan was, put a halter on old Walter. And we meant that shit, man. Oh, so we're talking about a development of technology that destroyed the old form of the factory system. It just obliterated it, man. But before it did, in Detroit, we had a ball. We made money, man. And we were able to raise our level of general culture, education, and science, man. Because they try to keep everything from a black motherfucker, man. I'm just telling you how it is. They don't want you to read a book, man. It used to be against the law to read a book.
Speaking of reading, I just want to take a page from Bach Squared from the University of KMT Press. Uh-huh. Bach Squared, page 650, where it reads, the lower section of the African middle class, specifically preachers, teachers, small business owners, labor leaders, comedians, comics, clowns, singers, actors, trumpet players, athletes, and other entertainers, were to be the raw material out of which this movement was to be fashioned, directed, and controlled. This minuscule lower middle class would lead the mass of poor working class blacks in head-busting marches, sit-ins, crawl-ins, beg-ins, boycotts, and other forms of civil disobedience. At the same time, lower middle class blacks were being led by white liberals and sometimes by those calling themselves radicals, social democrats, socialists, and even sometimes white communists. Accordingly, this ideology reflected what was occurring at the foundation of the United States economy. Blacks were being integrated into the urban mechanical labor forces at the bottom, and the increasing monies that they earned had to be spent somewhere. The white ruling class made sure that it was spent with them. The white ruling class needed the integration, the cheap African labor, and the increased domestic home market for manufactured goods to sell back to blacks. Blacks in the United States organized themselves into Nation of Islam, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, Congress of Racial Equality, CORE, Southern Christian Leadership Conference, SCLC, United Slaves, US, Detroit Revolutionary, DRUM, D-R-U-M, League of Revolutionary Black Workers, Black Liberation Army, BLA, People United to Save Humanity, PUSH, Black Panther Party, Republic of New Africa, Congress of African Peoples, etc., organized themselves and fought to achieve those ends. Again, that was from Box Square, University of KMT Press, page 650. So you pretty much lived, breathed, and participated in this struggle.
Yeah, like Takah Kilimanjaro, that's his book. Boy, it's breathtaking detail. It's refreshing. It's the kind of book that you like, you would put little slips of paper every so often, that way you won't yellow up all the lines in your book and mark on the pages, because 3 years from now, you'll be trying to read over the marks you made on the page. So you will put paper in and make notes in your different sections of the book, because it gives you insight into the moment and the components that was driving history. And yeah, he talked about DRUM and the League of Revolutionary Black Workers in particular, because he knows something about that. He was part of the end part of that history, you know, so that's cool. Like, we're talking about a development. See, the development, everything that happened, man, happened under certain conditions, a certain time, a certain place, just as methodology. So you have to locate yourself in time, which is hard, because time don't stop, but still you got to locate yourself, you know, which is impossible, but you still have to. After World War II, the world changed, the country changed. You had an industrial boom. You know, that created a certain form of the working class that was based on the last stage of the Henry Ford Revolution. In the 1950s, for instance, blue-collar worker, and blue represent manual labor. Blue-collar workers had dominated, but by the mid-50s, they noted that the proportion of white-collar workers was growing and the proportion of blue-collar workers shrinking. Detroit peaked at like 1.5 million people. And in the 60s, as the new technology was being applied, things started changing, but not before we get that last boost. Under Nixon, man, everybody bought cars because you had money. People couldn't drive, bought cars under Nixon. And Nixon was like this criminal thief, man. They called him Tricky Dick, right? And see, America's a criminal country. People like Tricky Dick because everybody was getting paid and making money and stuff. But Nixon did a couple of things I want to put on the back burner because we're going to come back to him. But Detroit was changing due to the technology in the 60s and stuff. The role of the League of Revolutionary Black Workers was to like kick in the walls of segregation. And once we did that, we outlived our purpose and began another transformation that allowed us to merge with the old currents of the Comintern and stuff. People be acting like Black people was affiliated with Karl Marx First International. People be acting like Marxism is some white man who snuck into town or something, man, it ain't like that. Black revolutionaries was affiliated with the First International because the white people in America didn't want to be with you, man. But Marx and Engels, man, was revolutionary to the highest water. That's just flat out, man. So the Bloods, yeah, you know the Brothers was affiliated with him through the Colored National Labor Union. Through the Colored National Labor Union, man. But I mention that because we get a concept that says somehow understanding Marxism as science of society is equivalent to kissing a white man's ass. And that's absurd. Especially considering that it's the Brothers that's been like dominating Marxism since the 60s. We want the narratives. In this country, Marxism, shit. We write the narratives, man. It's not foreign to us, man.
I always raise that as an argument when, you know, so-called African-centered or Afro-centered academics or, you know, I don't know what they want to call themselves, but it's people who are, you know, center their understanding and their studies or research around African history and culture. You can't name one so-called African revolutionary, whether here or on the continent, who didn't study Marx and reference his work, from Shikanta Job to Thomas Sankara, Amilcar Cabral, Nkrumah. You can't name anyone who didn't at least investigate the material in their research and in their personal and professional development toward revolution.
And see, and this is so dear to my heart because, okay, see, the Black Marxist is what makes the Marxist movement Marxist in the first place. Now, before us, man, you had the most privileged layer of the workers and intellectuals who have formed together on the basis of theories of communism and stuff. After 1917, man, when Russia went in the revolution and the Bolsheviks won, man, they created a polarity, man, and everybody wanted to be affiliated with Lenin, the Comintern, and Leninism. Well, it's the parties, the communists in America had to unite, man, into one organization and one group. But most of them, man, didn't accept what's called the colonial question. They didn't see nothing particularly stressful, man, about Black people hanging for trees and shit. They wouldn't, amen, but they was forced to by the Comintern. It was Lenin who wrote it, man, like you have to deal with Black people as a colonial question. They ain't looking for white people to tell them what to do. So that's why, like, ever since the African Blood Brotherhood went over to the Communist Party, in what, the 20s? The late teens, early 20s? Ever since then, we've always, black people, right? The black Marxists, the black revolutionaries, man. Hey, man, shit, they just didn't write our story. But jumping back, man, to Detroit, because of the factory system, the CPUSA, the Communist Party of USA, had a large factory organization. And the brothers, man, had always been affiliated with it and part of it through the National Negro Labor Council. The National Negro Labor Council was formed and backed by the Communist Party of USA because the Communist Party of USA was the first national organization that was integrated in American history. The Communist Party of USA, the first one, man. And it helped a hell of a lot that they did that. And we forever grateful, man, about the foot, man, Lenin and Stalin put on their neck, man. Because the white people here in America have been real tricky, man, deeply paranoid. They got us outnumbered 10 to 1, man. And they still scared. You don't supposed to treat minority populations. I don't mean in its color sense, but if a group is only 10%, you don't supposed to use violence on them and stuff. The violence is generally used when the majority is 80% and the 20% is being bad and they have to resort to violence. In America, man, these sick fucks, man, like, they got, see, okay, we got some serious problems, brother, to deal with murder and stuff, man. We be killing each other, man, you know. But I'm just saying, man, I ain't trying to ramble too much, but the whole continuity of history, right, and how it ran through Detroit, the factory system, the CPUSA having its largest factory organizations, the National Negro Labor Councils, right? That's the connection. That's why the blacks were able to lay hold of Marxism, man. Black men wrote Marxist Glossary. And well, we got help now. You know, we got a couple of platinum blondes that helped out with it, man. And you know the sisters was always there doing the hardest work and stuff like that. But I'm just saying, man, I don't like belittling Marx, man. I'm not with that, man. I have to get with somebody on that. And I read a couple of books. You did ask when specifically I ran into Marxism. And I was 16 to 17 years old. And I was in the League of Revolutionary Black Workers Library. And I pulled out a book called Ludwig Feuerbach and the End of Classical German Philosophy, man. And it fucked me up. Because I believe at 16, man, I was still believing in magic and that if you had the ability to focus your thought enough, you could pass through solid objects. I believe that because I was a kid, man, and I was captivated by bourgeois capitalist philosophy that says anything is possible. When I read Ludwig Feuerbach and the Classical German Philosophy, it taught me about something called a materialist conception of reality and that the world was real and operated on the basis of its own unique law systems. And our job was to discover the law systems. I was like, ooh, wee. I couldn't even say his name when I first picked up the book because I was calling him Ludwig, right? But I had a girlfriend who was very proper in a student English, and she told me it was Ludwig rather than by saying like Ludwig Feuerbach. That's what introduced me to Marxism. And from there, I run into Nelson Perry's group, the Communist League, coming out of California in the wake of Watts. We ran into them through the People's Tribune newspaper. It was, I think, either the first.
I just ordered his book, Nelson Perry. Yeah, I saw Father Takai reference it a few times. Reference, not the book, but learning so much from Nelson Perry.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I meet Nelson, and it had to be like 92, maybe 93. No, I'm sorry, 72, 73. Nelson said he was scared because we were so young and he thought the police was going to get him for like talking to kids and shit. But we had a whole crew of 20, 30 motherfuckers, man. At 17, I was the elder.
You know? Oh, that's just so amazing.
Hey, man, most of them was women. And they integrated. And when they went into the auto industry, man, that was the first generation of women. I was part of that, the first generation of women to have access to birth control. The world was very different. You didn't have women's spaces in society other than a woman's restroom. What that means is a motherfucker would try to run women down on the street and all that bullshit. Man, it was a different world.
Now, let me stop you for a second. Now, at 14, 15, mm-hmm. my peers, where I grew up, we was on corner selling cocaine. And today, you know, young people, it's hard to reach young people with, you know, intellectual development. You know, you at 16, 17, and we know from, you know, studying the Black Panthers that these were mostly teenagers and, you know, brothers and sisters in their early 20s who were studying, who were practicing, you know, drills, who were practicing public speaking, who were studying literature from all over the world. Do you think that there's too much block in this generation now? Like when you were coming up, y'all didn't have the sports and the video games and the rap and all that. What happened?
A fundamental breakdown and decay of the society that was built on the basis of the Industrial Revolution, specifically the Henry Ford stage. The society that was built on the basis of the Henry Ford stage of the Industrial Revolution came to an end. Revolutionary new technology, man, it tore motherfuckers, man, out of their roots, moorings in the old social order. Everything started collapsing, man. As people fled from the central cities, man, into the outskirts, the tax base was reduced, man. The maintenance of the infrastructure, it fell into disarray, man. Society started losing a certain optimism, man, that was generated from the industrial boom. The optimism, the belief, man, that you can always make it, that you would do better than previous generations. When you knew you could get a pocket full of motherfucking money, pay your bills, man, and marry the girl next door. That was a different world. It was gone, man. That society underwent revolution, man. Then the collapse of the school systems, man. This was deep because, see, the capitalists said we're not putting no money in it because that's not our point of view. I remember a society where you didn't have mass murders. It just didn't exist, man. Every now and then, motherfuckers getting the street fights, and now and then somebody would get shot. But this Chicago-style stuff, man, with 10, 15, 20 people get killed on the weekend, we ain't know nothing about that. I remember when they put dope in the neighborhoods, man. They created, man, like a torture chamber, man, because this is how the enemy thinks, man. It's his deep depravity. He deeply feels that he has to set humanity against itself in wars of annihilation because it's part of our predatory nature, man. So they reconstruct society in their ghoulish image, man. They're not bullshitting. That's why every movie you see on TV is about blood and guts and murder, to desensitize you so that you will accept the murder of your own species. And it still don't work. It creates depravity and degeneracy, but it still don't work, man. When I was a little kid, man, 8, 9, and 10, 11, and 12, we ain't really know nothing about no television, man. We had a television in the house, but the television in the house was deeply regulated. Like, people would talk about the Little Rascals and watching Little Rascals. We never could watch stuff like that. My mother forbid us from watching stuff like that. We never saw Amos and Andy. My mama forbid us from watching stuff like that. Every now and then we could watch Star Trek with her. So I grew up being a Trekkie. But what I'm describing is a different way of life and a different way of looking at reality. See, the industrial society create industrial pathways in your brain. Look at your brain like a computer machine, man. And then you got software that society has written into it and programming this shit. Yeah.
That's why this discussion is so important for me, you know, especially in regards to class, because today you have, you know, a class of Black people who are moving their way into politics. Black people are moving their way, into major seats, CEOs and corporations. So you have a class of Black people who are doing pretty good, who will turn around and tell you that the hood is the way it is because people are lazy, people are too infatuated with sports and entertainment, and that we basically, you know, we're destructive to ourselves, and that we need to follow, you know, what they're trying to do, like go to school and go to work. You know, they say these things. You need to learn financial literacy and all this stuff, and you can make a way out the hood. So that's why this discussion is so important.
You're going to have, man, a section of society that makes it because they're necessary for the running of society. It don't matter what their ideology is or what they say. In the sense of you are going to have X amount of people, let's say in our society, you're going to have 50 million people who will forever work, who will never be unemployed, who will always have a way to live and prosper, because that's how the system is maintained. And I'm saying that in the sense of the closer you get to being one of those persons, the more it looks like if an individual tried harder, they can make it. And it's true. But see, like, the point of view that says the individual is more important than the mass and the majority is precisely the ideology we're fighting. An individual can escape a class position, but a class cannot escape being what it is without the overthrow of the things that make it a class in the first damn place.
Powerful.
So, yeah, well, see, they, because they're closer, and for ideology, they preach the escape of the individual, and anybody can escape. Not only can the individual escape, everybody know people pass in America. The poor people want to pass like they goddamn it rich, and the rich people want to pass like they poor. Them really light-skinned Negroes, when they can pass for white, they get to do things, man, that your Black ass can't do. My point is that a point of view that begins and sees the individual as the locus, as the center, the pivot, is bourgeois. What we're talking about is the science of society, Marxism, man, and how classes and groups of people behave. We're talking about group behavior.
The science of society.
The science of society, man. If you don't define it as that, people start thinking you're trying to tell a man what to wear in the morning and how to talk to your old lady and all that shit, man. It's a science. It gives you the tools to unravel any society. But you got to use your, you know, the gray matter your mama give you to look at where you at, the conditions you want, to what's taking place. That's a whole nother logic and stuff, man. But yes, we're going to have these different class ideologies. I used to talk about the Black traitors of our people, our heritage, man, and everything we stood for. I did that for about almost 40. No, I did that for about 30 years. Yeah, it felt good for about 30 years and stuff, man. I remember when I didn't like Sammy Davis Jr., man. Well, I fell out of love with Sammy Davis Jr. because he was doing shit I didn't think he should be doing. And the fact of the matter is, he was brilliant. He was like this brilliant minstrel, man. But I fell out with him, man, because I thought, you know, Negroes shouldn't be dancing. And right now, man, all I wish I could do is dance every motherfucking day. When I die, it's going to be a picture of James Brown on my wall, man, not no president. But I'm talking about this culture, the ideology, how we raised in America, why we see things like we do, why we feel that we facing Black traitors because they won't reach back and get us, when in fact, man, we want a system set up in place where nobody's mentality and moodiness will cause a person to sink into destitution. How I get my everyday means of life, man, ain't nobody's business. Since there's enough available for all. For instance, we can just get Elon Musk, right, and take 90% of his money, just him, and that'll end poverty on Earth for almost 100 years. So I'm trying to set this up the right way because society coming apart.
And well, people would say we can't fault, you know, a billionaire for their success, and it's not fair to, you know, require them to share their success with everyone.
See, like, I don't be knowing how to answer stuff like that, man, because what I be looking at is that once we turn on the program so that that debit card communism kick in, where you can access socially necessary means of life anywhere in the country, man, with your card. We're going to reconfigure society in such a way that everybody get taken care of. We'll be able to pay for everything because the words pay for things mean labor that generate wealth. See, under the old system, you had to have money, paper to get it, not labor. You had to have money, paper to get it. And the only way you can get money and paper is if you work for somebody. Well, we ain't gonna have people working for other people. So you're gonna have to get your credit, your money another way. What we do is give you the credit and money you need for the rest of your life first. And in the next 80 fucking years, you gonna figure out how to pay for everything you got in life plus more, trust me. Cause it's math, man. It's a science to society and stuff. You know,
you but I really just, see this happening in this society, in this country?
See, I know it's gonna it get tricky. The communism part is happening in front of us. Who was it, Andrew Yang, who ran on the Democratic Party platform for president, who yes. wanted to give people what, $2,500 a month?
Yes.
As a big, that's a bourgeois capitalist form of communism. I'm telling you, it don't hurt nobody to give you this. But we want to do it from the standpoint of that revolutionary abolitionist. They're gonna give you your capitalistic form of communism. And you still not gonna be happy, man, because you won't have access, man, to life and society in a way that fits the mass of the people.
So we're still basically under someone else's domination and control, even though they say, here's a stipend for you to live.
Well, yeah, what's involved is that after we take power, all this child pornography and bullshit is not gonna be allowed, man. There's some stuff you ain't gonna do, man, because it's repulsive. We live under degenerate social order, man. It has its history. And we bring in a form of society to an end, but man, we're getting way in front of ourselves, man. The first thing we gotta do is try to win an abolitionist vision and a proletarian form of communism, man, where they ain't just giving you a fucking stipend.
That's a good segue because, you know, in these discussions, especially when you talk about radical change, revolution, revolutionary ideology or philosophy and Marxism, people want solutions. You know, people want to know, what do we do and how do we do it? So recruit and train up some people to prepare to move in a certain direction now. What would that look like?
Well, you know, it's two parts of that question. The first part is, first of all, I get them together in such a way where we start Zooming together as a way of life 2-3 times a week so that I can teach you the science of society. You have to be decontaminated so that at least you can see what's in front of you. Because you've grown up under, man, the philosophy and ideology of the bourgeoisie. Now, if you want to spend time in a breakfast program or something, that's cool. Do that. But see, look, what we need right now is educators and people with the ability to teach and tell the story of the vision of abolitionism. We have to win people over to a vision, not the practical work. See, we keep setting this up the wrong way. And the educators, man, we ain't trying to, look, we ain't serving the goddamn people right now. What we have to first do is figure out how to stay together and develop our vision of the society we're fighting for. What do you do when you get up in the morning under the society now that we're free? When you get up in the morning, man, and open your eyes and go to the bathroom and come out, you don't never have to think about how am I gonna eat? How am I gonna pay rent? How am I gonna pay for anything in life? It simply never enters your mind. What enters your mind is, how can I be my best self today? What do I want to do today? And you live like that because no one is no longer tied to having to take your place on the labor front, producing socially necessary means of life. Once upon a time, dads taught their sons, mothers taught their daughters a certain skill and labor that they had to carry out in society. Revolutionary means of production changed a society built on the hands of human labor and doing all the work. So we're talking about a society where you're looking in the corner, man, at your heirloom tomatoes that you had been growing because you just felt like fucking around to see what you could do, man. And you get on your computer, man, and you might want to punch up a joint in, Korea, man, that makes something, and you enter their computers and look at their machines because you have figured out, man, a new thing on software programming. Then you might want to check, man, on your application because you have been trying to, like, work at a Stanford Medical Center. But they got a waiting list of, like, 150,000 people. Because it ain't a shortage of labor on earth, man. So everybody, like, got a number in line to be able to take part in the highest levels of society and stuff like that. Like, you got people, man, who want to send their kids to specialized public schools because they want their kids to have the experience of being with, like, a group of 2,000 to 3,000 people. But the schools can only hold 1,800 at a time, so you got a waiting list. You're talking about a society, man, of beauty that's structured different, man, where we not exposed to war propaganda as a way of life. We walk different, man. We glide through the fucking air, man. The air hit you different when life is enhanced, man, by peace. I'm telling the truth, man. The vision of what we're talking about is in front of us, but it has taken the Black Marxists to win this battle, man, where we make our vision, our minstrel shows, our act, our poetry, our narratives, man, where we unfold beauty, man, in a way dominated, man, by our narrative. I think that fight has been won, man, and we get opportunity, man, to change history and be on the right side. Because we've done ugly things, man. We've done beautiful things. We carry jazz, man, into Europe on the end of a motherfucking bare neck. Because we were part, man, of, like, the imperial master. You know what I'm saying? We was born into it, not by choice, man, circumstance. So our story is of love and glory. It is a case of do and die. It's all of that and more, man. And that's what I'm hoping we talk about, man, in series and episodes.
Absolutely. I look forward to digging deeper into that because, you know, that's some of the work that I've personally been doing over the last 5 or 10 years. And I just find it, you know, such a struggle. My focus, again, is on Black African people. But it's such a struggle to do this work. It's like you're competing with the entertainment.
Yes.
And at a very young age, like I said, I was on the street corner when I was 14, 15 years old. And you could still reach me. You know, I remember coming up. If you walked up on us with a pamphlet and said, hey, young brother, read this, I would have took it and I would have read it.
Yeah.
But these young brothers and sisters now, you present information to them. Some of their young minds are so fried and their egos and their attitudes are just so horrible that you can't even approach them.
And see, but it's going to come from within their peer group. What happens is every now and then we get lucky and we make a connection that allows somebody 16, 17, 18 to become a conduit for our narratives that make them part of the continuity.
So we have to groom them. You're saying we have to groom those people.
Yeah, but you know, like, yes. And I'm hoping that our tapes and kicking it, man, have an opportunity to reach people. Because some of this I'm going to segment, man, with time and present. But yeah, man, we'll win as long as we remember that our first task is as educators. As educators, man, we have to get educated for real. It is imperative, man, that our absolute leadership of our section of the social movement be felt, man. We're not trying to tell people what to do in the world. We're not trying to be the head of an African world revolution, man. And I was in South Africa, and I'm telling you, man, the comrades tired of hearing shit about how somebody in fucking America, the head of the African revolution. I'm telling you, they tired of that, man.
I bet. I dig it. You know, I just posted on Facebook something the other day. It just came to me. A three-step process. You know, we talk about Black liberation or African liberation. The first thing we have to do is free the mind. You know, to your point, education is number one. And then step two is to free the resources, the means of production. And then we talk about freeing people. You know, we can't discuss liberation or the freedom of people if the minds and the resources aren't even liberated yet.
Right, man, I get it, man. I just be talking because if we ever forget that we live as part of empire, we're going to make just an inexcusable mistake, man, that could cost us dearly. Like, we are part of an empire with 1,000 military bases and more military bases being beefed up and activated in Africa right now in real time. We have to really look at what our first responsibility is. And the first responsibility, in my opinion, is to shut the fuck up about all this shit about African fucking revolution and overthrow these motherfuckers right here. I'm quite serious about this. It will change the fate of Earth. It is imperative we teach of what society is composed and how we're gonna affect a change where we don't end up with bourgeois communism. Mm. We're going to get communism, but we want it from the standpoint of abolitionists. I'm not afraid of my African heritage or nothing, man. I'm an old Pan-Africanist, man. That's flat the fuck out, but what they meant by Pan-Africanism, when Du Bois, man, and them founded the motherfucking end, going through the post-World War II period, is a little different than what they talk about today as Pan-Africanism. It's just different, man. When you're talking about a world in the 20s, where the only place for imperialism to expand is the colored people, man. Pan-Africanism, you know, you can call it whatever you want, but what you're talking about is a revolutionary struggle against imperialism and the imperialist system. Yes, it has the form of color, because it was white people colonizing the color. That's why it looked like that. But I'm just saying, man, how we look at the world, we Americans. I'm telling you, you go overseas, man, they let you know who you is, man. When I was in South Africa, I was very careful, man, not to be offensive, because it's not like we can tell people what to do. And I figured since we sing and dance for white people in America, we can sing and dance for our goddamn brothers. So I gave them a good show, man, and let them know I was all right. But we got to be Marxists, man. And I see, that's what will unite us. But when you say Marxists, for some people, everybody still see white people, man. I don't get that. Cabral was blowing Marxism. We loved the Marxism of Cabral when he was alive. I remember Absolutely. When he was alive, man.
Absolutely.
He was bad when he was alive. General and the brothers who founded the Drum and League of Revolutionary Black Workers, they was in Cuba in what was it, 63? With Fidel and Che?
Yeah.
They played ball with Fidel and Che, man. You know, so they got a feel for Marxism that was different. And they got that feel because, okay, when you went to Cuba, you had to fly out of Canada, right? Cause of the blockade, which was fresh, new, and stuff like that. When you flew out of Canada, they took you to Eastern Europe, Czechoslovakia or something. And from there, you come back to Cuba. My point is that when the brothers was in Czechoslovakia, it was cold and damp, and it was a dreary-looking motherfucking socialism. When they landed and got to Havana, man, it was fucking on, man. Because it was black, Caribbean color, right? It had that old African base feel to it, man. And I'm saying it because that's the real world we live in. That's the world we live in, man. I'm just saying, so you got me talking, man, like, you know, I'd be getting pissed, man, if anybody act like Marxism is white. In America, what book you done read, man? I even don't know where that comes from.
This is, you know, this is why I do appreciate, you know, the opportunity to speak with you, because I'm learning. And I always say that I'm learning, even at my age, I'm 42 years old. A lot of this information I came to when I was incarcerated. We studied Marxism, we studied revolutionary science, we studied, you know, dialectical materialism. We studied all of this stuff, you know, freedom movements, any Black power movement, liberation movement you could think of, we went through it, but we never really discussed how to apply it, and we never really discussed what it meant scientifically. You know what I'm saying? Some of the brothers were really great at explaining things, but it never shaped me enough, you know, to get out and do anything. And as I got older and have children and family, and of course the world's changing, you know, I'm starting to see these things and go back to that study. And then I, you know, found the University of KMT Press, and that material just sparked a flame in me, because it explained this whole narrative in a African way that was so dynamic and so new that I just fell in love with it. And I never dismissed anything that came from any corner of the globe as being irrelevant or being non-African or being too white, because we're in trouble. And we have to figure out how we're going to get out of it. So I appreciate you, and I look forward to continuing this dialogue.
And can I close out giving you a book? The name of the book is The Future Is Up to Us by Nelson Perry. And if you Google it and put Marxist anti-revisionism, Marxist anti-revisionist, a copy will come up where you can look at it and read it online. It's by Nelson Perry, a Black Marxist. He wrote it 20 years ago. See, our stories just be hard to get out, man, because you know how they do to Black peoples. You know how they do, man. Shit. But anyway, The Future Is Up to Us by Nelson Perry. Google Marxist.org. It's somewhere there.
Yeah, I'm familiar with the website. I've gotten a lot of great downloads from that website. They just, you know, publish so much of Marxist, Mao, Leninist information that I've been able to download, you know, get PDFs and just read and study so much. So
you got more time?
Go ahead, whatever you have left, go ahead. We got time. Got about 10 more minutes.
I had left off in Detroit. We went through the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. See the changes that have taken place, man, in the structure of society, in the collapse of the old structures. And what has turned out to be a deep pessimism. It's a deep pessimism that permeates the entire ideological sphere. And all of it has been created by the enemy. The enemy is acutely aware of the ideological sphere, and they have millions of people involved in the work of intelligence. You know, we just don't take seriously that they take their job serious, including how they want us to think things out. Our fight is over the life of the mind, how to think things out. And that comes with being part of the continuity of history. And any way we look at it, we're talking about Marxism, the science of society, as a framework to understand society. To understand our own history, we talk about an abolitionist vision, because we've been trying to abolish all forms of slavery, including this last form, which is called wage slavery. They call it wage slavery for real.
Yes, absolutely.
And the reason why is because it's the last form. That's where we are at as Black people, in the most imperial, right? See the comrades in Africa, and Africa is made up of these relatively large states, and each state has its own peculiar history and its own different political parties and stuff like that. But most of them nowadays have some kind of socialist or Marxist party, you know, which gives us a real foundation to demand adherence, man, to at least a Marxist outlook and outline of society. That means we have the basis, the infrastructure for a form of organization that can become very, very significant in a small period of time. You know, that's the importance of Marxism, the science of society, and using a neutral scientific approach to general things. It don't mean everybody gonna be on the same page and same paragraph, but it gives you a basis, a foundation. And I'm saying that, man, because we got Marxist brothers and sisters in all the different states in continental Africa. They can best speak about the continental situation rather than us proclaiming ourselves the head of the African Revolution. And I'm serious about that, because I got some brothers I love who don't understand the inherent danger in that. You know, and that's why I'm repeating this, you know. They know I'm saying it with love and stuff like that, man. You know? But I think that's about me, man.
Well, let me ask you, and yes, you know, in closing, I'll wrap up here, but as far as struggle goes, you know, with Black people in America, how would you define Black struggle in America? Because we can't look at it the same way we do the anti-colonial struggles on the continent of Africa or anti-colonial struggles anywhere else in the world. So how would you define Black struggle in America?
By first of all, establishing that in the United States of America, North America, we have what began as a settler state. The state is this like government and standing army taken together to rule your society. We have a settler state. To call it a settler state means that it was people come from someplace else who come over and kicked the shit out of everybody who was already here, murdered half the motherfuckers, man, and drowned the land in a sea of fucking blood to establish their hegemony. Once their hegemony was established, they built an architecture of society, which means the rules, living quarters and placement, everything in society. They built it with colonial architecture to ensure that people colonized by them will remain at the bottom of the social order. A huge group of people that come over to the new land was Black peoples. And we were brought here, colonized, and we have been held in conditions of endless murder, periodic waves of genocide, man, since we got here. And the best way to overthrow that rule is to make a cold assessment of what you need to change the system. And you need a minimum of 60 to 80 million people on the street. So if we're talking seriously about the fate of Black people as colonial, we ain't talking about a Black struggle. Unless if that's like what you want to call it, that's cool. Man, I call this struggle one that overthrows heaven and earth, man. That we bring 10,000 years of history to an end. You can't compare this to no colonial revolutions, man, or the post-World War II period, which was glorious in their own right. But this is the big one. You know, so when we talk about our role, we're talking about a group of colonials that's been brought into the heart of empire and how we win people over to our vision, which is of emancipation based on the abolitionist lens. That's everything. But I don't call you, you call it the Black struggle. That's cool, man, how you frame it. But I'm hoping I'm framing things in such a way where it's understood I'm talking about the people in this country in their millions. I ain't talking about no kid like estimate of, oh, we got white people and we got Black people. No, read some. You got to read and study more, not you, but you. So you got to read and study some more. Let me jump for a minute. Donald Trump got 74 million votes. Biden got roughly 83, 84 million votes. You add them together, you're talking about 160 million people. Another 100 didn't vote. That's 260 million people. When I talk about needing 60 to 80 million people, man, in protest, a mass uprising, you're talking about being able to dislodge the state a certain way. I'm saying this because January the 6th, Trump tried to tilt it in his favor through a practice insurrection. When we talk about the Black plight in America and freedom, we're talking about having the ability to analyze how to do things based on a line of Marxism that developed on the Black hand side. So that's how I see the Black situation in this country, making a cold assessment. Now, we have to acknowledge that ever since that what? May 25th foul murder of George Floyd, roughly 24 to 28 million people have been involved in protests, most of them white. Something different is taking place in this country, man. I never thought I'd live long enough to see.
So you're talking of a call toward racial solidarity of the proletariat.
You can call it whatever you want, man. What I call it is some young white people, man, having a sense of outrage about murder. And I call it that because that's what I saw. Now, solidarity, I see, okay, look, okay. Them people protesting is open to propaganda and information that express and articulate an abolitionist vision. That's our jobs. Somebody gonna teach them. We have to figure out how to stay in touch with folks in such a way as to give them an abolitionist vision. That's how I see carrying out the fight, man.
Understood.
Yeah, man.
Understood.
And it's the Black dudes, man. I'm telling you, this is deep, man. Because you know they usually don't let us live too much longer past, what, 50? Hmm. And I snuck in 68 years, man. Like, I'd be glad wow. every day, man. I'd be glad.
Wow. Well, I'm glad too, because if not, we couldn't be here dialoguing today. We couldn't get this work done. So, Elder, again, I am definitely moved by your words, and I look forward to future discussions. This has been phenomenal. We got some great feedback from our first discussion, and people definitely wanted to hear more. So
sending their questions and stuff, whatever it is, man, we're getting to, man.
Absolutely. For our listeners, you hear what the Elder has to say. Elder, could you please leave your contact information or the best way people can get in touch with you?
You can go to Facebook, Darryl Waistline Mitchell, or you can go to Marxist Glossary Discussion Facebook, or you can write me. I'm at Waistline, Waistline, @gmail.com. You can find me there.